Yeah, he drove around and visited up along that Turkey River. He spent a lot of time along the Turkey River, and then he'd visit through the country. And yeah, my dad corresponded his son for a long time, and even during the war, he couldn't get a set of tires up to Europe, so my dad sent him a set of tires from here.
How do you think Spillville's changed over the last 100 years?
We still speak Czech up here yet. There's quite a few of us still speak Czech. But it's more intermingled now, you know, the other younger generation moving in. Yugoslavia, another one. I've come across a butcher up in La Crosse here not too long ago. Now, he had a funny brogue on him, so I asked him, actually, he's a Yugoslav, unless you speak Czech. And he says, yeah, so away we went. This is the old boy feeding pigeons up there. This is his later home then.
This was at Dvorak Doings in 42.
This is where Dvorak used to like to spend most of his time up there. It was at the lower end of the park up there. And there's a bend right in here. The river bends up in here. There's a cottage up on the hillside there.
As you're growing up here, or
as I was growing,
yeah.
Well, there was no blacktop and no pavements, dirt roads, hitching posts. Not in the square, but in back of the stores, there were hitching posts. And I drove a horse to school till the eighth grade, and it was 5 miles from our place to here. And my grandparents lived here.
After trying to piece together a picture of what Spillville was like when Dvorak was here in 1893, I got to wondering what Dvorak would think of the sights and sounds of contemporary Spillville. Girls around Spillville?
No, kind of.
Pretty much, but there's not that many kids around.
Not that many good ones.
Do you get a lot of Czech visitors?
Yes, and I do not understand the language. My folks speak it, but they never did teach us kids how to speak. I can say "Jak si máš," and we say "Dobře," and it means "How are you?" and we say "Fine."
Here's a bust of Anton Dvorak. He was the great Czech composer who spent the summer of 1893 here in Spillville. And at that time, he occupied the upper story of this building. In the center, the gentleman with the fur hat is Joseph Spielman. He was the first settler in this community, and it was after him that the town of Spillville was named.
So, do you get really tired of giving those tours?
Yeah.
Saying the same thing again and again?
Yeah, it's not bad, like, now, because today's the first day of work in the season, so it's not bad today, but, like, towards August and September, it gets really long.
What's the dumbest question they ask about the Dvorak?
If his daughter really ran away with an Indian. We don't know if he did or not, but everyone asks us that.
At the end of the summer, Dvorak knew that he had to return to New York and eventually to Prague. But in mid-August, a band of Kickapoo Indians, led by the tribal leader, Big Moon, arrived in Spillville, and every night of their stay, Dvorak would listen to their tribal music. If you listen closely to his string quintet in E-flat, the second major chamber piece he composed in Spillville. You might hear an Indian influence.
Three Indians come here and they put on a dance, you know, tom-toms playing, and he was sitting in the front row, and but I've heard that he was sitting in front taking notes, you know, and then they claimed that part of his World Symphony or something is also included in that, from that Indian tom-toms in their dance. But that one time they were saying that his daughter was interested in a Indian, and so he got mad and pulled out. But then again, here is some farm boy that she was interested in. So at night, he just picked up lock, stock, and barrel, and out they went. Or in the morning, they were gone, heading back for New York.
Like Dvorak, I departed from my last visit to Spillville early in the morning. And I returned to Kalmar via Highway 52, which I learned was named the Dvorak Highway in 1925.
Thank you.